Hi, I'm Amy Goodman. Democracy Now! Is committed to bringing you the stories and perspectives you won't hear anywhere else. From the peace activists demanding an end to war, to indigenous leaders fighting to stop fossil fuel extraction and save the planet. Our independent reporting is only possible because we're funded by you, not by the weapons manufacturers when we cover war or gun violence, not by the oil, gas, coal, or nuclear companies when we cover the climate crisis. We count on your generous support to keep Democracy Now! Going. Please make your donation of $5, $10, or more at democracynow.org. Every dollar counts. Thank you so much. We're counting on you. Stay safe. From New York, this is Democracy Now!
I'm furious. I'm furious that yet more innocent lives were taken by gun violence. While we celebrate the 4th of July just once a year, mass shootings have become our weekly, yes, weekly, American tradition.
Six people were killed, at least two dozen injured when a rooftop gunman armed with a high-powered rifle attacked a 4th of July parade in the Chicago suburb of Highland Park Monday. We'll get the latest. Then we go to Ohio to look at the fatal police shooting of Jaylen Walker. Police in Akron shot the 25-year-old black man over 60 times after a traffic stop.
They want to turn him into a masked monster with a gun, and we knew that. But I want to thank the chief for one thing he said. At the time he was shot, more than 90 or 60 or whatever the unbelievable number will be, he was unarmed.
The city of Akron is under curfew. We'll speak to the Reverend Ray Green of the Freedom Block in Akron, as well as former Ohio State Senator Nina Turner. Plus, we'll talk to Sewell Chan, editor-in-chief of the Texas Tribune, about the twin tragedies in Texas, the Uvalde school shooting that left 21 dead and the shocking death of 53 people seeking refuge in the United States, found inside a sweltering tractor trailer in San Antonio. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. A warning to our viewers and listeners, our top stories include graphic details and images of gun violence. In Illinois, six people were killed, at least two dozen injured, when a rooftop gunman armed with a high-powered rifle attacked a 4th of July parade in the Chicago suburb of Highland Park Monday morning. Five of the shooting victims died on the street. A sixth died in the hospital. Victims ranged in age from 8 to 85. Eyewitnesses described a scene of terror as parents scrambled to protect their children from the attack. Following an eight-hour manhunt, police arrested Robert E. Cremo III, known as Bobby, a 22-year-old resident of Chicago's northern suburbs, an aspiring musician who performed under the name Awake the Rapper. Some of his videos depict mass murder and school shootings. Cremo's father runs Bob's Pantry and Deli in Highland Park and ran an unsuccessful mayoral campaign against the city's current mayor. Illinois Governor J.B. Pritzker responded to the shooting Monday.
I'm furious because it does not have to be this way. And yet we as a nation, well, we continue to allow this to happen. While we celebrate the 4th of July just once a year, mass shootings have become our weekly, yes, weekly, American tradition.
According to the Gun Violence Archive, there have now been 315 mass shootings in the United States so far this year. Highland Park has an assault weapons ban, but the latest news is that Bobby Cremo obtained his rifle legally. We'll get the latest on Highland Park after headlines. In Ohio, outrage over a police shooting in Akron prompted mass protest over the weekend as people demanded justice for 25-year-old Jaylen Walker, a black man shot dead by police after a traffic stop June 27. The protests erupted after police released multiple body cam videos from the shooting in response to earlier demands from the family and local activists. The newly released video shows eight officers chasing Walker after he got out of his car and ran away. The video ends with the police firing 90 rounds, hitting Walker 60 times, according to an autopsy report. Walker was unarmed when police shot him. Lawyers for the family of Jaylen Walker say after police shot him, they handcuffed him before administering first aid. Elizabeth Page White is a lawyer for the Walker family.
Jaylen was shot more times than I can count. And that is beyond troubling. We are done dying like this.
The city of Akron, Ohio, canceled its 4th of July fireworks show Monday and has issued a downtown curfew ahead of the results of a state probe into the police killing of Jaylen Walker. We'll get the latest on his case later in the broadcast. The Food and Drug Administration says it will not require large-scale clinical trials for new formulations of COVID-19 boosters. The FDA made the announcement as a panel of experts said drug makers should prepare vaccine boosters for the fall that are tailored to combat Omicron variant sublineages that are currently dominant in the United States. Nationwide, about 17% of coronavirus tests are coming back positive, the highest test positivity rate since a massive surge in COVID cases last winter. In Texas, the state Supreme Court ruled Friday a century-old law banning abortions can take effect following the U.S. Supreme Court's landmark decision striking down Roe v. Wade. The Texas ruling means anyone providing an abortion could face lawsuits and financial penalties. Whole Women's Health has since suspended abortion care at its clinics across Texas. In Ohio, a 10-year-old girl who became pregnant after surviving rape was forced to travel to Indiana for an abortion after she was denied the procedure in her own state. Ohio's trigger law ban on abortions came into effect with the Supreme Court's historic Dobbs v. Jackson ruling June 24th, banning abortion after 6 weeks of pregnancy with no exceptions for children and victims of rape and incest. Russian President Vladimir Putin has declared victory in the eastern Ukrainian region of Luhansk after Russian forces overran the city of Lysychansk. Ukraine's military says it organized a tactical retreat and will focus on preventing Russia from pressing west from the occupied Donbas region. On Monday, Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky called for the creation of a $750 billion post-war recovery plan for Ukraine, saying the rebuilding effort should be partially funded by Russian reparations and asset freezes. WNBA superstar Brittany Griner has appealed to President Biden for his help securing her release from a Russian jail after she appeared in a Moscow area court Friday for the first time since her arrest. Griner was detained by Russian authorities February 17th after customs officials allegedly found cannabis oil in her luggage. In a handwritten letter delivered to the White House Monday, Griner writes, quote, "As I sit here in a Russian prison alone with my thoughts and without the protection of my wife, family, friends, Olympic jersey or any accomplishments, I'm terrified I might be here forever," she wrote. The Biden administration's unveiled a draft proposal to lease new oil and gas drilling rights in federal waters off the coast of Alaska and the Gulf of Mexico. The Interior Department unveiled the plan just ahead of the July 4th holiday weekend. It's the third time since November the Biden administration's announced new oil and gas leasing plans on the Friday before a holiday. The climate watchdog group Oil Change International blasted the announcement as a, quote, "stark betrayal of President Biden's climate promises and the communities who will suffer the brunt of this drilling. Biden is choosing to stand with big oil and gas rather than the voters who elected him and who overwhelmingly want a swift transition to renewable energy," they said. In Australia, some 50,000 residents of New South Wales have been ordered to evacuate their homes after torrential rains brought devastating flooding to areas around the capital, Sydney. Australia's fourth round of severe flooding in less than a year and a half came as some 8 inches of rain fell in just 24 hours. Climate scientists say such extreme precipitation events are becoming more common as warming land and sea temperatures allow the atmosphere to hold more moisture. In northern Italy, at least 7 people were killed Sunday as a glacier collapsed and skidded down a popular climbing route in the Italian Alps. Rescue crews using helicopters and drones are searching for more than a dozen others who remain missing in the Alps. The glacier's collapse came as temperatures at its summit hit a record 50 degrees Fahrenheit and as Italy's government declared a state of emergency from a severe heat wave that spawned drought across much of Italy and wildfires near Rome. Italian Prime Minister Mario Draghi on Sunday blamed climate change for the glacier's collapse.
The drama was certainly unpredictable, but it definitely depended on the deterioration of the environment and the climate situation. Today, Italy weeps for those victims.
The Biden administration said Monday the bullet that killed Palestinian-American journalist Shireen Abu Akleh likely came from Israeli military gunfire, but stopped short of saying investigators had reached a definitive conclusion in her killing. Shireen Abu Akleh was shot in the head May 11th as she reported for Al Jazeera on an Israeli army raid in the occupied West Bank, even as she wore a flak jacket and helmet clearly marked press. Palestinian groups and several media organizations, including CNN, The New York Times, and Al Jazeera have determined Abu Akleh was killed by Israel's military. So has the Israeli human rights group B'Tselem, which accused the Biden administration of whitewashing her death. Shireen Abu Akleh's niece, Lina Abu Akleh, responded to the State Department's inconclusive findings Monday.
We were expecting that such an investigation would actually hold the perpetrators accountable and would carry out a transparent investigation that is free from any political pressure. However, that was not the case. We will continue to call for justice. We will continue to call on the U.S. to carry out a transparent investigation by an independent body. In addition, we continue to call on the U.N. and the ICC to carry out an investigation and hold Israel accountable and put an end to this grotesque impunity that Israel continues to endure.
President Biden will be visiting the Middle East in a few weeks, and Chilean President Gabriel Boric has received a draft of a new constitution whose fate voters will decide in a mandatory referendum September 4th.
As president, it is my duty to call upon a constitutional referendum as I receive this proposal today. That is why we came. It will once again be the people who have the last word on their destiny.
If approved, the new document will replace the constitution created under the dictatorship of Augusto Pinochet, who came to power in a 1973 coup supported by the United States. The new constitution enshrines human rights and social programs, including free universal access to health care, higher education and reproductive rights, as well as more robust environmental safeguards and policies to promote gender and racial equity. It also, for the first time, recognizes Chile's indigenous peoples and offers restitution for historically indigenous lands. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman in New York, joined by Democracy Now! Co-host Juan Gonzalez in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Hi, Juan.
Hi, Amy, and welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world.
Well, 6 people were killed and at least 24 injured when a rooftop gunman armed with a high-powered rifle attacked a 4th of July parade in the Chicago suburb of Highland Park Monday. The gunman reportedly fired dozens of shots at parade-goers shortly after 10 in the morning. 5 of the shooting victims died in the street, a 6th in the hospital. The Chicago Tribune reports the victims ranged in age from 8 to 85. Eyewitnesses described a scene of terror as parents scrambled to protect their children from the attack. One father, Alexander Sandoval, said he hid his son in a dumpster to protect him.
We were sitting right in front of the stage where the parade announcers were announcing, and it was probably about, you know, 20 to 30 feet away. I thought that it was the Navy that was saluting the flag with the rifles, but then when I saw people running, I picked up my son and I started running. I ran to a niche in one of the buildings of the local shops there, and I tried to break the glass to get in with my son, and I couldn't break it. And when the shot stopped again, that's when we decided we had to run. So we started shooting again, and we ran behind the building, and I put my son in a dumpster, and he sit there with his dog, and I went back to look for the rest of my family. I left him with someone there so that I can go back to get my phone and find the rest of my family, because they ran away also, and it was just horrible. I went back, there was a few people shot on the ground, and there was a little boy that was in one of the police officers' arms, and that was the worst experience ever, because, you know, all I thought about was my son, and I can only imagine what that family's going through.
Illinois Governor J.B. Pritzker condemned the mass shooting and called for an end to what he called this plague of gun violence.
I'm furious. I'm furious that yet more innocent lives were taken by gun violence. I'm furious that their loved ones are forever broken by what took place today. I'm furious that children and their families have been traumatized. I'm furious that this is happening in communities all across Illinois and America. I'm furious because it does not have to be this way. And yet we as a nation, well, we continue to allow this to happen. While we celebrate the 4th of July just once a year, mass shootings have become our weekly, yes, weekly, American tradition.
About 8 hours after the shooting, police arrested Robert E. Cremo III, known as Bobby, a 22-year-old white local resident who police described as a person of interest, now a suspect. He was detained after a short car chase. He's been described as an aspiring musician who performed under the name Awake the Rapper. He released videos depicting mass murder and school shootings. He also once posted an image on Twitter draped in a Donald Trump flag. His father runs a local deli called Bob's Pantry in Delhi, and ran unsuccessfully for mayor of Highland Park in 2019 against the city's current mayor. According to the Gun Violence Archive, there have now been 315 mass shootings in the United States so far this year. Highland Park has an assault weapons ban, unlike all of Illinois. But apparently, Bobby Cremo purchased his gun legally. We begin our show with Nina Turner, who served as co-chair of the Bernie Sanders 2020 presidential campaign as a former state senator in Ohio. In a moment, we'll talk with her about another incident of gun violence, the police shooting of Jaylen Walker in Akron, Ohio. But we want to begin by looking at the mass shooting in Highland Park. Nina, thanks so much for joining us again. You know, Highland Park, just days ago, were honoring the Uvalde victims of the mass terror that happened there weeks ago. And we're going to go to what happened there, go to Texas later in the broadcast. But you've been tweeting nonstop about the Highland Park mass shooting. Can you comment on what took place yesterday on Independence Day?
Yeah, good morning, Amy, and also Juan. I mean, we are a nation under siege. And this is worse than the Wild Wild West, because at least in the Wild Wild West, you knew you're going to have to duel with somebody. So people were prepared. These type of mass shootings leaves everybody vulnerable, no matter their age, from an infant to the most seasoned person in this nation is left vulnerable. And when you cannot take your family to a parade, you can't go to the grocery store. I'm thinking about Buffalo. Your babies are not safe in schools, Uvalde, and other incidences over the last past 20 years in this country. We have a problem. And part of this problem is the gun obsession in the United States of America. And unfortunately, we have too many elected officials who are bought and paid for by the NRA, who do believe that the Second Amendment is more absolute than any other amendment in the Constitution. What happened to the ability to pursue life, liberty, and happiness? Part of that means that people should be able to conduct their everyday activities without fear that somebody is going to have a weapon and shoot them. And for the folks who say that this can happen anywhere, well, you know what? It's sad that it is primarily only happening in the United States of America. When you compare our country, Amy and Juan, to other industrialized nations, they do not have the same level of mass shootings that we have in the United States of America. So it is time for these elected officials, especially on the federal level, to stop playing games and to do something about it. And to extend that, we need state, local, and regional elected officials too. One thing for sure, you can't even rent a car if you're 21 or 22 years old. We need to increase the age by which somebody can even purchase a weapon, because their brains are not even developed properly yet. And that's the science, and especially men, Amy.
And Nina Turner, I wanted to ask you about this issue of age. So many of these shootings are perpetrated by young white men, 18, 19, 20, 21 years old. Your sense of what is happening in some sectors of our society among young men?
Well, why is this macho nature? It is really this toxic masculinity that I got to have a gun, that equating gun with manhood, period. That is happening. And all of the racial animus is bubbling up to the surface. We as a nation have not dealt with racism and xenophobia, you know, anti-Semitism, anti-blackness. We just have not dealt with it in this country. And the chickens are coming home to roost, certainly starting with the election of President Donald J. Trump. But all of this was happening in the United States of America before that man was elected. So we cannot sit here and say that it is just because he was elected. We have neglected to deal with a violent past and a violent present in the United States of America, wrapped in white supremacy, wrapped in bigotry in all of its forms, wrapped in sexism, and certainly wrapped in anti-blackness. And Juan, until we are willing and able to deal with that, we're going to continue to have these problems. And I'm sick and tired again of these current elected officials. Thoughts and prayers are good. We need some action. We need some policy changes. That must happen. And my last point, trauma. People in this country are facing trauma. We need to have a way to help people deal with the trauma that they are facing. I'm not just talking about people who've been diagnosed with some type of mental illness. I'm talking about the heaviness of the trauma of this moment between the pandemic, between all of these mass shootings, between inflation and people not being able to afford to live. This is a traumatic situation. And this problem calls for big policy pushes, such as having Medicare for All so people can get the services that they need.
And when you talk about doing something, that was the refrain that people told President Biden in Uvalde. And yet here we are once again. Something was done, but obviously it wasn't sufficient in any way to deal with the scope of the problem of gun violence in America. Your
Juan,
sense of
done,
what the politicians did to do.
But why they haven't even passed the George Floyd Act, for God's sakes. Democrats begged the voters of this country to put them in. My party told people, you vote for us, it's going to be different. Maybe there is difference in the way that they present, but in terms of the material conditions of people's lives being changed, the George Floyd Act has not passed right now in this very moment. So what needs to happen, number one, is pass the George Floyd Act. Number two, get rid of the filibuster. Stop playing games so that we can have more things be accomplished in that Senate. And for those talking about wait till November, vote us in. We don't even know if the Democrats are going to still have control come November. We need action right now. People are dying right now. People are in pain right now. And it is not enough for elected officials to have the power right now in this moment to put this off. They got to act right now and act with a sense of urgency. Even Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. talked about the fierce urgency of now. So let me say to that, the fierce urgency of right now, right now, right now. Use that power.
Finally, Nina Turner, online, this suspect, Bobby Cremo, had a vast presence. I mean, this is not like Uvalde. He talked about suicide. He talked about mass shootings. He lived on Discord, yes, on Twitter, on YouTube. He was into fash wave music. That's fash as in fascism. Ben Collins, interestingly, of NBC News, made an interesting point when talking about these loners. He said, you can't call them loners anymore. They have a total community online, and they are egging each other on. And he was very present there as a rapper, rapping about mass killings. If you can talk about both the fact that he got his gun legally, this according to the mayor of Highland Park, who just revealed this, and the fact that he was a presence, so may not have been the local police not focusing on him. And that may well go to the issue of, as the media was trying to decide whether to call this a terror attack, you know, he clearly wasn't Muslim. And so they veered away from that. But this idea of this being a cell online.
Yeah, I mean, it's Oklahoma City, you know, that's this. And this country, again, has a race problem. And white males are treated differently than everybody else. And if his parents, again, even though he was grown, I cannot understand that his parents didn't see some of this, too. We have a problem that needs to be solved.
He lives
in the United
with his
States
father
of America,
and uncle.
And it's wrapped with racism and bigotry. And let me say this too, Amy. He was arrested without incident. Arrested without incident. We compare that to Jaylen Walker, which I know we're going into.
We're going to go to break right now so we can talk about Jaylen Walker. Nina Turner, please stay with us. Former Ohio State Senator, recently a candidate for Ohio's 11th congressional seat, former national co-chair of the Bernie Sanders 2020 presidential campaign. Yes, next up, we go to Ohio to look at the fatal police shooting of Jaylen Walker, stopped for a traffic violation, shot by police over 60 times. Stay with us.
Talk, let's have conversations in the dark. World is sleeping, I'm awake with you. With you. Watch movies that we've both already seen. I ain't even looking at the screen, it's true. I've got my eyes on you. And you say that you're not worthy. You get hung up on your flaws. But in my eyes, you are perfect as you are. I will never try to change you, change you. I will always want the same you, same you. Swear on everything I pray to that I.
Conversations in the Dark by John Legend. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Warning to our viewers and listeners, this segment continues to include graphic details, in this case, about police violence. Outrage over a police shooting in Akron, Ohio, prompted mass protests over the long weekend as people gathered outside the police department's headquarters and marched downtown to demand justice for 25-year-old Jaylen Walker, a black man shot dead by police after a traffic stop June 27th. He was shot more than 60 times. At one point, protesters were confronted by police in riot gear who shot tear gas at them. The protest came after police released multiple body camera videos from the shooting in response to earlier demands from family and local activists. Police say the videos show a gunshot being fired from the car driven by Jaylen Walker before he tried to drive away after police pulled him over for a minor traffic violation. Police say a gun was later recovered from his car. Jaylen Walker was unarmed when police shot him dead. The newly released body camera video shows eight officers chasing Walker after he got out of his car, was running away. The video ends with the police firing 90 rounds and shooting Walker about 60 times, according to the autopsy. In this graphic video from the police footage, you can hear the barrage of police gunfire.
You f***ing move!
Hey, get
prayers for the family of Jaylen Walker say after police shot him 60 times, they handcuffed him before trying to provide first aid. These are Walker family attorneys Bobby DiCello and Elizabeth Page White.
Jaylen was shot more times than I can count. And that is beyond troubling. We are done dying like this.
They want to turn him into a masked monster with a gun, and we knew that. But I want to thank the chief for one thing he said. At the time he was shot, more than 90 or 60 or whatever the unbelievable number will be, he was unarmed.
The city of Akron canceled its 4th of July fireworks show Monday, has issued a downtown curfew ahead of the results of a state probe into the police killing of Jaylen Walker. At a protest Sunday, demonstrators put their fists in the air to remember him with a moment of silence. For more, we go to Akron, Ohio, to speak with one of the people helping to lead protests calling for justice. Reverend Ray Green, Jr. is executive director of the Freedom Bloc. Bloc stands for Black-Led Organizing Collaborative, based in Akron. And still with us in nearby Cleveland, Ohio, former Ohio State Senator Nina Turner, who was recently a candidate for Ohio's 11th congressional seat and was a national co-chair of the Bernie Sanders 2020 presidential campaign. Reverend Green, let's begin with you. Describe the chronology here. What you understood happened when Jaylen Walker was killed, and then what happened after video was released.
Good morning. It's very simple. The video shows that a black man was spotted driving at night in an area he probably shouldn't have been spotted, was profiled, was then chased and gunned down like he wasn't human at all. Any other narrative is a disgrace to what we've seen in the video. What we've seen in the video is what I just described, an unarmed black man being chased and gunned down. And that's the simple facts of the matter.
And Reverend Green, in terms of how the police chief has handled this situation since it happened, could you talk about that as well and the rapid release of the videos, which is unusual in a lot of these cases. Police try to hold back these videos for as long as they can.
First of all, in respects to the rapid release of the videos, the Freedom Bloc, along with Judy Hill, the NAACP, and other community leaders, ensured that this process happened. We were on the committee to ensure that body camera footage was released. So other than that, this camera footage would not have been released, but we fought for a year to have this body camera footage released in a timely manner. We actually wanted it quicker than that, but because of the FOP, we have to wait 7 days to get that footage. But I don't put any of this on the chief. He has some blame to shoulder for this, but this is about our public safety director, Charles Brown. This is about our mayor. This is about two men that have been in power, that have continued to let the culture of the Akron Police Department be ran by the union as opposed to what the citizens of this city needs. We have no control over this police department. Our mayor has no control over this police department. The only one to have control over this police department is the police union, the FOP. And that is the problem that we see. And now we just need new leadership. We need a new mayor. We need a new public safety director. And that's the only way that this problem is going to change. With the FBI coming in, putting together a consent decree, Homeland Security, doing a check on this department, a thorough investigation on this department. The FBI has already put out the report that all of these police departments have been infiltrated by terrorist groups, by white supremacists. In Akron in the 1920s, had the second largest Ku Klux Klan base with over 400,000 members. And that's what we see in our police department today. Is a culture of racism, a culture of police that's not from here, that has very little interaction with black people. And this is what they think of. They chase us down and they gun us down. for a taillight violation that, as you see on the video, is not evident.
And speaking of that, could you talk about the police killing of 42-year-old Jeffrey Stevens back in July, I think it was 2008, eerily yes. similar to this incident?
Yes, a young man who was a pillar of his community, who was protecting his block, protecting his street. What we asked our citizens to do, and the police rolled up with no context, not being from here, not living in these communities, put up with no context, and gunned him down. There is no other way to describe murder but to describe murder. This is murder. And our police are getting away with murder because our state representatives refuse to get rid of qualified immunity, refuse to put together legislation that protects citizens. They rather protect buildings. We have instilled a curfew here because we rather protect buildings while we're being gunned down like target practice for the lack of a taillight that is not even present in the video.
Is that what they say the traffic violation was that they were pulling him over for? Taillight?
Yes, a broken taillight.
Nina Turner, if you could weigh in here. This is a story you're all too familiar with. In fact, I went with you. You took us to the playground.
We did.
When the police had opened fire on how old was the little boy in the playground?
Tamir Rice.
Yeah. Tamir Rice.
Yeah, Tamir Rice was 12 years old.
12 years old.
Yeah.
The police
yeah,
killed him within seconds in the playground.
That's right. That's right. I remember like it was yesterday and us having that interview, and it was because of what happened to Tamir Rice that, you know, the governor, John Kasich, and Governor Kasich is certainly a conservative Republican. Everybody knows I'm a hell-raising humanitarian. But we were able to get together, and the governor created a task force on community and police relations because of that murder of Tamir Rice. We wanted to make sure that there were no incidences of violence that would erupt in the city of Cleveland or throughout Ohio. And we understood that people needed to have their voices heard. And that was in the latter part of 2014, Amy, as you remember. And we traveled the entire state in 2015 and collected information from citizens all across this state about how they felt about relationship or lack thereof with law enforcement agencies in the state of Ohio. And for the first time in Ohio's history, there are standards for, and the first standard we put together was the use of deadly force. So one of the questions I would have for the mayor of Akron and the chief of Akron is whether or not they are adhering to the standards of the use of deadly force and the use of force. Now, standards alone cannot do it. I agree with the Reverend in that this is a cultural dynamic, not just in the Akron Police Department, but in police departments all over this country. And it is very much coupled with a whole notion of treating Black bodies, Black minds, Black spirits as somehow less than everybody else. And if you are a Black man in America, you are indeed an endangered species. And that the laws that have been created in this country and the way that they are the way that they are implemented shows it very clear that there is no respect. That was a firing squad that happened to Jalen. And so we have Cremo, who just killed people, injured folks, armed. He was taken unharmed. You know what? He's going to have his day in court. It would have been nice if Jalen would have been able to have his day in court, too. But no, he's a Black man, so he is treated differently. And I'm not saying that I want white men, white young men or older men, white men treated the way Black men are treated. What I do want is for Black men and boys to be treated like we treat white men and white boys. Police officers are not here to be judge, jury, and executioner. No matter what had happened, they should have brought him in. And certainly 60 bullets hitting this young man's body, and then they handcuffed him and then try to perform CPR, whatever the hell they said they were doing. You can't do. He's a man. He's not superhuman. He was a man, a young man, but they treated him as though his life did not matter. The Black Lives Matter movement, that's what it meant, Amy and Juan. Black lives matter, too. It is curious to me how these mass shootings among white men, they can be, they'll be picked up, they'll be taken to Burger King. They live to go to court. But for Black men in particular, they don't. We have a problem in this country, and we got to deal with it and stop playing around with it.
And Nina Turner, I wanted to ask you, in terms of the Black Lives Matter movement, it seems to me, and I've covered police and law enforcement for more than 40 years, so I'm very familiar with how police departments work. It seemed to me that in the aftermath of the Black Lives Matter movement, many of these police unions and police forces around the country almost entered into a slowdown. They no longer wanted to fight crime because in some ways the police unions egged their members on to say, OK, they want to put the cuffs on us now. They want to restrict us. We're just going to let crime soar. And in fact, a lot of this crime, the soaring of the crime rate that so many other people mentioned these days, I believe is a result of deliberate actions by these police unions to change public opinion. I'm wondering your sense of the power of these police unions across the country.
So they are all powerful. And Juan, I do agree with what you're saying in terms of the slowdown. I know that they're good law enforcement. You know, I have law enforcement in my family and I get it because I can see this I try to see it from all of the sides. But there come situations where there is no gray. And what happened to Jalen, there is no gray. And so we need to, law enforcement agencies, good police officers, need to be just as outraged as Reverend Green and I are. They need to be just as outraged as the Black elected officials of Summit County who are really standing up and taking a leadership position in this, calling on the Department of Justice to come in and do an investigation. One thing that the city did do that I definitely agree with is to ask the Ohio Bureau of Criminal Investigations to step in, because the city of Akron cannot be trusted to do its own investigations. And Reverend Green just laid out why they cannot be trusted. So we need the Ohio Bureau of Investigations, but we also need the DOJ to step in here as well. We have a cultural problem within law enforcement agencies in the United States of America, and culture can be and must be changed, and it must start at the top, and there must be consequences for when that culture is not changed. Another thing that needs to happen is that more people of color need to be recruited to be in these law enforcement agencies, and more women as well. Not saying that either of those two groups are perfect, but when we look at a chain of violence at the hands of police, it is usually at the hands of white men. So cultural dynamics and what policing really means. Does it really mean to protect and serve? Because in Black and brown community, it doesn't mean protect and serve. It means to lord over. That is a different mentality than what law enforcement has when they are in other types of communities. Again, this is an American problem. Police officers, law enforcement agencies are just a microcosm of what is really happening in this country. And you know what it is? Black lives really do not matter. And that is shown time and time again, that white supremacy, that bigotry, and that anti-Black racism is in full effect in these United States of America. And we need some truth and reconciliation. And what happens at the hands of law enforcement too often just reminds us of the unfinished work in the United States of America.
Finally, we just have 30 seconds. Former Ohio State Senator Nina Turner, but I wanted to ask you about the 10-year-old girl in Ohio who became pregnant after surviving rape, forced to travel to Indiana for an abortion after she was denied the procedure in Ohio because Ohio's trigger law ban on abortions came into effect after the Supreme Court struck down Roe v. Wade. Your response?
I mean, Amy, I fought with those Republicans when I was in the legislature. And unfortunately, you're right. The trigger law, she was a little over 6 weeks, a 10-year-old baby who was just in kindergarten a few years ago. Ohio is child abuse. There's nothing another way that you can call this. It is absolute child abuse. It is a stain on the state of Ohio. We are now, as far as I'm concerned, the worst state in the union at this point after what happened to that 10-year-old baby and her having to go to Indiana. They wanted to force her to bring a rapist. A 10-year-old should not be having a baby. I mean, it's just too much. It is too much. And we got to use our rage and our outrage to push for change.
Former Ohio State Senator Nina Turner, we thank you so much for being with us, as well as Reverend Ray Green, Jr., Executive Director of Freedom Block, Block standing for Black-led Organizing Collaborative based in Akron, Ohio. Coming up, we go to Texas, where Uvalde's school district police chief has resigned from his new position on Uvalde's city council. We'll talk about the mass shooting, what we know, more significantly, what we don't know about why there was so little action to save those 21 people, 19 of them fourth graders in Uvalde. Stay with us. When the Night is Over by Lord Huron. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. We end today's show in Texas, where Uvalde's school district police chief Pete Arredondo has resigned from his new position on Uvalde's city council before ever sitting in a meeting. Arredondo said he made the decision to, quote, minimize further distractions. He's faced widespread criticism over his handling of last month's school massacre when an 18-year-old gunman shot dead 19 fourth graders and their two teachers. State authorities say Arredondo was the incident commander who ordered officers to wait in the school's hallway for over an hour instead of confronting the gunman. Texas Department of Public Safety Director Steve McGraw described the local police handling of the shooting as an abject failure. Arredondo says he didn't think he was the incident commander. To talk more about the Uvalde shooting, we're joined by Sewell Chan, editor-in-chief of the Texas Tribune, which has submitted dozens of public information requests in an effort to force local and state authorities to release more information about the police response to the massacre. Sewell Chan, thanks so much for being with us. It is unbelievable to think how much media has been in that town and how little information has been released from Uvalde to the Texas legislature, to the Rangers, Department of Homeland Security, local police were all in that school as 19, 10-year-olds at around that age, and two of their teachers were shot dead. They waited for an hour, even though they, too, had automatic weapons and shields, we have now learned, and the doors were open to the classroom. Tell us what you know, Sewell Chan.
Hi, Amy. Yeah, you really captured kind of the devastating portrait that's been portrayed by, you know, state officials here in Texas. In addition to the question of the, you know, who was in charge of the incident, and again, the crucial discrepancy, Arredondo told us he did not think he was the incident commander, but the radio transmissions and other broadcasts that we reviewed suggest that people did consider him in charge. There's also the discrepancy of whether, in fact, the doors were locked. You know, the chief told us that he thought that the doors had been tried and found to be locked, and that the reason for the delay was that they were waiting for a master key to arrive. Now there is a lot of suggestions that, in fact, the doors were unlocked all along. There are also other discrepancies. There was a talk on the transmissions of a Harrigan being available, an axe-like tool that firefighters used to enter the classroom. Why was that never used? And then finally, the question of the radios. The chief said he ditched his radios because he was responding to the scene and felt that he didn't need them. But that cost him, of course, a crucial line of communication.
But Sewell, help me with this. When you have multiple law enforcement agencies come to the scene of the crime, how do those in charge, let's say, of the Uvalde Police Department or of the state police cede their control to basically a chief of a three or four man school police department?
Well, that's one of our questions. And Uvalde doesn't even have a single police department. It has a city police department, which was on the scene. And it also has the school's police unit, a six-officer unit that was created 4 years ago. So one of the questions we're asking is, why didn't the federal or state authorities who were on the scene take charge of the incident?
And in terms of the refusal of anyone apparently to get Chief Arredondo to testify in one way or another about what he saw or what happened?
Yeah, there are very much efforts to get him to testify. Even that has been a source of confusion, because the chief says that he already gave testimony at least two times and that he wished to get a transcript of that initial testimony before talking to the Texas Department of Public Safety a third time. And it's not yet clear whether or not that transcript has been provided.
Would you say there is a major cover-up going on, Sewell Chan, that goes right up to the state? I mean, we're talking about an area which is along the border. They have poured millions into the police. And you had every level of authority in the state and feds, right, the Department of Homeland Security. There is, every time I hear it, all relying on this one man, as Juan was describing, the lowest level of the police, the school's police chief. You have to raise questions about this whole Lone Star Fund that has militarized the border. I mean, if those were undocumented people inside, you could only imagine how quickly the police would be or the feds would be moving in. These children in the local community, what happened?
Well, Amy, as a journalist, I tend to avoid the word cover-up unless there's a demonstrated conspiracy of some kind or demonstrable kind of obfuscation. But I agree with you completely that the heavy militarization of the region raises profound questions about why the police and law enforcement response was so lacking, right? I also do want to draw attention to the gun safety aspects of this. I mean, the gunman was armed with an AR-15, and we all know what those kinds of assault-style rifles and weapons can do. And I think that if you watch the video carefully, as we've done, part of the hesitancy of the officers going in, I think, was genuinely, confronting kind of a military style, kind of a weapons environment. And I think that raises profound questions about the kinds of arms that people have that they're allowed to have and hesitation even of trained law enforcement to go in there and confront that.
Sewell Chan, we wanted to go back in time with you because your paper, the Texas Tribune, did an amazing video. And it's about activism, not from today. And clearly, the local residents are getting very active and angry. But it goes back to Robb Elementary School. Not the first time police were involved. This is a video produced by the Texas Tribune about how Evalde used to be known for a 1970 Hispanic student walkout. It features two people, Alfredo Santos, a walkout organizer, and Rebecca Ciprian Moreno, a retired Spanish teacher who took part in the boycott. We want to play the whole thing. It's just about 5 minutes, and I'll read what's written on the screen.
I was in the walkout. Uh-huh. I was a junior in high school, and it was April of 1970. I was sitting in my English class. We were already kind of waiting for the sign to walk out. Alfredo Santos, I remember, opened the door and he just kind of nodded, and we knew it was time.
In 1970, over 600 Mexican-American students in Uvalde walked out to protest unjust education system, one of the largest demonstrations during the Chicano civil rights movement, and became entwined with the city's identity.
This incident at Robb is not going to be the first time that the public schools have been in the spotlight of controversy. I was 17 years old. It was seat of the pants. We would plan at night. We would review what happened during the day. So we started at the high school at 10 o'clock, and people started getting up, and you could see all the people moving. People got up and joined us. We had put together a list of 14 demands. We wanted more Mexican-American teachers. We wanted more books having to do with Mexican-Americans in the library, things like that.
We had no Hispanic teachers. We had all white teachers. We had all white school board. Hispanic positions were like the cafeteria workers, the custodians, I do sadly remember my second grade teacher. She walked up to me and got me by my ear and just pulled and pulled and pulled and pulled. And I remember crying and crying, and blood was coming down my cheek right here. And I remember the beatings on her hands for speaking Spanish. That would never happen to the other kids, ever. In a way, we felt inferior because we just thought we were inferior until we got closer to eighth grade, and then we, as kids, started talking to each other.
The walkout started with high school students, and then we got students out of the junior high school, and then students from the elementary schools.
They tried really hard to kind of demoralize us. I remember helicopters flying kind of low because I remember the noise. Their favorite word to use, and it sounds really bad, it was dirty Mexicans. And one of the ladies came out and threw some soap bars at us. And I remember the guns, that they had guns. At one point, I saw a gun pointed at us. And that was very scary. I think we all were scared.
The school district was forwarding names of students who were in the walkout to the local draft board. I went down to the draft board office, and we confronted the lady at the draft board. She looked on some list, and she saw my name there. And I told her, well, I'm not even 18. And her last words were, you just wait till you turn 18. I'm going to get you. So I left during the fifth week of the walkout. We had bet the house and we lost, so to speak.
After 6 weeks, the start of summer ended the walkout, but the Uvalde School Board ignored the students' demands. The protest sparked a decades-long discrimination lawsuit against the school district that led to a desegregation order.
Uvalde was known, we were known for the walkout, and it was one of the biggest in American history. It was a positive thing. Now I can imagine that people will say around the world and say, oh yeah, that's where the shooting happened. But the fact will remain forever that we were known for the walkout.
Some people consider the walkout in Uvalde to be una mancha negra, and something that it's a hurt, and they don't want to bring it up. But it's algo que sí pasó. Just like this massacre on May 24th. Yeah, it's a black mark, but there are people who, you know, prefer to have the luddy-duddy version of history. They get Dale Evans, they get Matthew McConaughey, and non-controversial stories. La vida no es así.
That report by the Texas Tribune, reporters Uriel Garcia and Ginesau Hernandez, Juan?
Yeah, I'd like to ask Sewell Chang why you decided to break this story or go back into history at this time in terms of Uvalde, because obviously there were walkouts throughout South Texas in those years, in California in 68, the Chicano high school walkouts then. Why you decided that this was important to tell now?
Juan, well, we felt that it was very important to talk about the activism in this community, that the fact that a half century ago, during the Chicano movement, the Mexican-American political movement, there was a surge of activism. And, you know, my question has been, what's happened since then, right? This is an overwhelmingly working class, overwhelmingly Hispanic community. As Amy pointed out earlier, it's become heavily militarized. It's relatively close to the border. And, you know, these are a lot of the families have, you know, folks in law enforcement working in Homeland Security or Border Patrol or even ICE, which is one reason why South Texas has become more politically contested, with Republicans making some substantial gains in the last few years. And so we felt it was important to connect that history of activism to the story of what's going on today, where the power structure, you know, remains pretty overwhelmingly Anglo. And, you know, what happened to that moment of kind of relative hope and relative, you know, political energy a half century ago?
Sewell Chang, we want to thank you so much for being with us, editor-in-chief of the Texas Tribune. We want to talk to you about San Antonio, the 53 migrant deaths. We'll post it online at democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan. Please stay safe.